Jefe, what is a plethora?
It's been a decade, as Jim mentioned, since the Mirror Creation Conference that we attended. And in that time, there has been quite a bit of progress addressing questions of the emergence of complex structures. The first slide shows essentially two models of explanation of trying to deal with the sort of thing that Michael Behe's talked about, an irreducibly complex system. You have a number of molecules here, protein molecules, that come together in a complex way to produce something that's functional. And the argument is, how can you get natural selection for this when these have no function separate from their role in the structure here? Now, an alternative that is a Darwinian explanation is that you had proteins that initially had a different function, either the function was no longer needed, or by well-documented genetic mechanisms, extra copies of genes are produced, and through mutation, new sequences arise such that new functions can emerge, and selection can act on those, and ultimately, as they start to form a new function, these functions may continue through gene duplication, you get the function here. This process is called exaptation. So one of the challenges for Darwinism is, can people working in the modern evolutionary synthesis produce, find evidence in nature of this sort of exaptation occurring? Next slide is the flagellum. And there's over 50 proteins, a very complex piece of molecular machinery. And however, working on the premise that there might well be exaptation occurring, people have been looking at the sequences of the genes for these different proteins and looking for homologies with other functional protein clusters in bacteria. About 85% of the proteins have been identified. Now, this doesn't prove that that's how it happened, but it's at least suggestive of the possibility of exaptation and allows for the possibility of guiding further research. It's possible, I'm not going to make a prediction, but I'll say it's possible, when we get together 10 years from now here, that we might have to concede that this has a story, you know, can be explained by a series of exaptations and is therefore not irreducibly complex. On next slide, but also there's more that we can do these days. Now this is an article in the April 7th issue of Science. I'm not going to make the assertion that this somehow disproves irreducible complexity. What's rather, I think, is interesting about this particular experiment is that it involved deducing an ancestral sequence from comparative studies, making that gene, then making the protein, looking at its properties, and essentially working out mutational pathways and gives, in the test tube type experiment, showing how an exaptation might have occurred. I think that's what's interesting in the experiment. The next slide. A few pages further on in that issue of Science, there's an enzyme, beta-lactamase in bacteria that, if it has five mutations, can produce 100,000-fold resistance to antibiotics. And they were able to, with having the gene and then doing the tricks of biotechnology, to work out all the possible mutational pathways, the sequential steps. Not all of them are susceptible to being selected, but there are several of 120 pathways. There are a few. They can actually quantitatively estimate how likely they are, and there's a green line here of the most likely pathway of mutation. Again, as we get information about the flagellum, we might be able to do these experiments and see is it possible or not that there would be a Darwinian pathway to get there. The next slide. This is from last week's Nature. It's another type of line of evidence in terms of retrotransposons and their functions in cells. And you probably can't see here, but the basic point is that they assert that this is one of a number of examples in terms of these novel jumping gene type experiments that indicate that there is exaptation occurring. Now, the question I'd like to put to the panel is this. Although research on Darwinian exaptations is still very much a work in progress, at least progress is being made. And in contrast, I'd like to know where the progress is in our understanding of such biochemical systems that has been gained from the intelligent design theory per se during the past decade. Given this contrast, why would a scientist abandon the productive research program of the Darwinian modern evolutionary synthesis for one informed by intelligent design?
Can I start with that one?
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. I kind of suspected. Well, I would submit, kind of as a preliminary, that there has been no Darwinian progress on explaining molecular machinery, and that all of the stuff that has been alluded to and much, much more is actually just regular biochemistry, which is being spun in a Darwinian fashion. Let me start with the bacterial flagellum and the type 3 secretory system. The idea which has been popularized by Ken Miller is that perhaps this type 3 secretory system, which is actually kind of just a little injection apparatus, could have been a precursor to the bacterial flagellum, which is in fact a rotary motor. And to get across the problem with that, I'm going to start with kind of a cartoon example that I started with and Ken Miller picked up on. I started to illustrate the idea of irreducible complexity. I used a mouse trap, and I think probably many people in the audience are familiar with that. A mouse trap has a number of different parts, and all of the parts are necessary. And in a number of different venues, Ken has said, well, you can use the mouse trap for other things. You can use it for a clipboard. You can remove pieces and use it as a keychain. You can even use part of it as a paperweight. Oh, thanks very much for putting that up. I was going to surprise people with these pictures, though. And here's a real mouse trap. And it sounds pretty good when he says that, but when you see pictures of real clipboards and keychains and paperweights, somehow the idea is this would be used to make a keychain, which would be used to make a clipboard. This would somehow end up as a mouse trap. And I want to emphasize that it's real easy. There's kind of a rhetorical dissymmetry or asymmetry in this debate, in that Darwinists want you to think that making transitions is easy. So they'll kind of say, oh, well, that's no problem. Let's just start with a paperweight, and then we can go to a keychain. So it's not irreducible. But I would suggest,
just the only thing is that going from a paperweight to a keychain is not the same as going from a gene for one function to another. That maybe 5 mutations are sufficient.
Yeah, well, this wasn't my analogy. This was Ken Miller's analogy.
Okay.
And I just want to suggest that here's the problem. Not only is this, I would consider this an intellectually unserious response to the problem of irreducible complexity. Another problem is that if you ask yourself, if you start with some structure that's being selected to be a paperweight, it's not going to be prepared at all to be a keychain.
Okay.
A structure that's a keychain isn't going to be prepared at all for a clipboard. And if somebody says, I'm going to accept this and use it for a clipboard, well, you may as well say, I'm going to accept a paperweight. You haven't gone any of the way towards a clipboard.
But Michael, what about the question I asked?
Okay, I thought I was answering it. Now, let me continue then. Could we go to... skip the next 2 slides to the third. This is kind of a slide that's similar to the one that Professor Weber showed. There we go. Thank you very much. And here's the idea. Suppose you have an irreducibly complex molecular machine made up of six different parts labeled A to F. Suppose that they started out as individual precursors, each of which had their own function. Could you, next slide, please. Now suppose they got together somehow. Now you could have an irreducibly complex machine, the story goes, but each of the parts had their own function. And I submit that even if all of these things are doing the exact same thing they would do in the irreducibly complex machine, you still can't get from these parts to here, even if they're doing the same thing. And why is that? Well, here's one reason. Proteins are not little colored squares.
Exactly.
They are not little colored figures like Ken Miller showed on his slide. Why does the A go next to the B here, besides being in the alphabet there? Why doesn't it go down here? Why aren't these in a line instead of something like this? What makes a real protein stick to another real protein and another real protein stick to that? They stick to each other because they have very complex surfaces which are matched to each other. The chemical and physical properties have to be just so, like little magnets that are lined up in order to allow them to bind. Could I have the next slide, please? This is the real problem that would face that scenario. You would have proteins, A, B, C, D, which did not have the right shapes in order to bind to each other. In order to form an irreducibly complex molecular machine, they would have to pre-adapt all of their shapes in order just to bind to each other.
Michael?
Yes.
Again, I would like you to address the issue. What I was talking about were not only hints from the comparative sequences, but the fact that we have the technology now to take those genes and, you know, get putative ancestral sequences, mutate them, find out how the proteins might fit together, look at perhaps functional intermediates that are along that pathway that you put the X's on. And what do you tell the scientist who's pursuing that kind of program that will give them a better research program that they should abandon that approach for an ID approach?
I don't think they should abandon it. I just say that they aren't doing a Darwinian approach. They're simply looking for different structures and then ascribing the results to Darwinian process.
Well, I would assert that it's being guided by understanding of both common descent and also selection and principles.
No, I don't think so. Let's take, for example, the science paper that came out that you spoke about, the Thornton paper from the laboratory of Thornton at, Oregon. They took a protein, they made a protein using information from current proteins, and this protein that they made was able to bind three different, what are called steroid hormones, three different kinds of steroid hormones, which one of the two proteins, the modern proteins, can do itself. Then they introduced a couple of mutations into it, as suggested by the sequence of another of the modern proteins. And they saw that the three steroid hormones bound to the mutated protein about 1,000-fold less strongly than they did before. And as far as I could see, that was the result. They started with a protein that had an ability. They introduced a couple mutations. It decreased the ability. Now, in my mind, that says nothing at all about how one could get an irreducibly complex molecular machine like this, or the flagellum, or any such thing.
And of course, my point was it's not irreducibly complex, that issue, but the technology opens the way to do experiments to address the issue of these interfaces.
Here's a critical, I mean, just briefly say, so Steve wants to say something. Here's a critical problem. At no point did they investigate whether any of these things conferred a selective advantage on an organism. You can make whatever you want to, But in nature, if Darwin's theory is correct, the pathway has to be given advantage to the organism. Their intermediate that they made bound the hormones that the starting protein bound significantly less strongly. To my mind, I would be very suspicious that that was a detrimental
Well, it was a change in specificity of the protein that occurred.
But clearly, you can't extrapolate, though, that to anything significant when you're losing using binding strength. And also, Ralph Silke, who's here, a biologist from Wisconsin, and he's used the analogy to capture what was done. He said it's like you have a key that will open two locks, and you have some random grinding on the tines and the key, and then you can open one lock at mm-hmm. the end. This is clearly not the kind of change that can be extrapolated indefinitely to produce significant biological change. So a lot of these results that you're pointing to, we welcome. We're delighted that people are taking Mike's work seriously enough that they're trying to refute it. That's the kind of thing that indicates the existence of a scientific debate. Right. But we don't think that the results have refuted Mike or provided a better explanation. I'd like to talk just briefly about the type 3 secretory system, because there's a very clear, testable scientific implication of the two competing theories here. Mike's theory is that the system is irreducibly complex and that it indicates a prior intelligent design. The type 3, or the co-option hypothesis, acceptation, as you call it, of Ken Miller, indicates that the type 3 secretory system and the genes that produced it were an ancestral form, a precursor. There's two clearly different implications. Well, one says that the genes in the type 3 is older than the bacterial flagellum and the genes that produced it, and the other says just the opposite. The design hypothesis has the implication that the bacterial flagellum and the genes that produced it are older. That shows that there are empirical implications that are testable. First of all, these two competing hypotheses, Mike's as well as Miller's. Now, interestingly, the data that's coming in is showing that the type 3 is a devolutionary byproduct of the molecular machine. The genes for building the type 3 secretory system are, in several different cases, show the same thing, that the information is derivative of an aboriginal genome. The genes are often carried on plasmids for building the type 3. They are often in islands of pathogenicity that show that they have been imported from outside the system into the aboriginal genome. And there is one case where there are the genes for building the whole of the motor, but the genes that are expressed early for building the type 3 are all that get expressed. And so but the whole of the rest of the genome is there present, but an insertional mutation has prevented the rest of those genes from being fully expressed. So there's a lot of evidence piling up that the genes for building the type 3 are younger, and that the genes for building the bacterial flagellum are older, which confirms Mike's hypothesis over and against Miller's. And I would further submit that simply pointing to something that is conceivably an intermediate form does not meet the challenge that Mike has laid down.
No, I'm accepting that.
Okay, because his challenge to provide a fully Darwinian explanation for the origin of a complex molecular machine like the flagellar motor, you need not just to have a platform of function somewhere along the way from simple to complex. You have to have a series of functionally selectable intermediates. And we know such a series doesn't exist precisely because these systems are irreducibly complex
It seems like you're assuming the answer.
No, they're irreducibly complex in the specific meaning that people doing knockout experiments know. That if you knock out a gene in that the 30 proteins that make up the flagellar motor, you know that you lose function. That is to say that the immediately precedent steps on the way from simple to complexity are non-functional. And so the challenge has not been met of a gradual account of the origin of those molecular machines. This hand waving and referring to paperweights and stuff is all kind of cute, but it's a word game rather than an actual scientific explanation.
But I would still assert that it is through this sort of information about sequences these can be resolved, but to what it is still being driven, not by, I can see, intelligent design. I don't see laboratories dedicated to that, producing these kinds of data.
Well, Steve, Bruce, we welcome that. I mean, that's your research program. Go for it. You know,
Paul, we
welcome that. Yeah, but we've got a different research program. You should keep at it and see if you can meet Mike's challenge. But just because people are working on it doesn't mean that we should stop doing what we're doing.
May I respond to a comment that Jim made originally? And I'd like my slide number 29, please.
Good luck.
Slide 29.
I want to recapitulate Jim's remark and then respond to it. He said, why are we having this debate at Biola in what he implied was a religious setting? Why isn't this debate going on in a scientific setting? And I'm waiting on my slide. While I'm waiting on it, I'll give you a story. In October last year, I was in Washington, D.C. To speak at the American Enterprise Institute, and I went to the American Association for the Advancement of Science building, which is the largest organization of scientists in the country, to hear a scientist from Caltech named Chris Adami. And the room was jammed, the auditorium was jammed, very much like this room is tonight. And Chris Adami was describing an experiment that he and Richard Lenski and some colleagues published in Nature, one of the very journals that Jim mentioned, next to Science, the most prestigious science journal in the world. This experiment, which I'm sorry, that's not slide 29. could you give me slide 30, please? Yes, thank you. This is the experiment he was describing, published in Nature, a major paper. And that night, Chris said, I want to tell you why I began this research project. And he flashed up a slide of the cover of Darwin's Black Box. He said, Mike Behe has made an argument about the nature of living things, namely that they have these irreducibly complex properties. This is a fascinating argument, and I want to respond to it as a scientist. So he and Lenski and his colleagues wrote a computer program to try to evolve, via Darwinian mechanisms, apparently irreducibly complex instruction sets. Now, the AAAS videotaped that speech. It was clear that that night, Chris Adami's research was to respond to the scientific case that Mike Behe was making. In detail, the whole context of his research was to do that. And this paper, published in Nature, was to do that. Can you advance it one step? This is the opening sentence of the abstract. A long-standing challenge to evolutionary theory has been whether it can explain the origin of complex organismal features. Now, notice the verb here. It's a passive. Who is raising that long-standing challenge? Well, it wasn't Chris Adami. It was Mike Behe. It was the people on this panel. Now, here's why this is weird. There's a funny kind of asymmetry with respect to intelligent design in the scientific literature. It's perfectly possible to critique intelligent design and to publish papers like this in Nature. But Mike Behe would have a very hard time getting one of his own papers in, making a case for irreducible complexity in the same journal. Now that, I think, is like playing a game of softball with two sets of rules, one for the home team, one for the visitors. The debate about intelligent design has been joined in the scientific literature. One of the papers that Bruce Weber put up from Science just a couple of weeks ago, Chris Adami wrote a commentary, a News and Views commentary about that paper. The title of that commentary was Reducible Complexity. And the whole argument of his commentary was, we now have evidence to answer Mike Behe's case about irreducible complexity. So this is the other most prestigious journal in the world making a case against irreducible complexity. So you can see that a debate has been joined in the scientific literature about intelligent design. It's already going on, but there's this funny set of rules. One set of rules for the home team, one set of rules for the visitors. I look forward to the day when Mike can make his case in the same journals the way his critics can. Thank you.